Welcome to The Real News. I'm Eddie Conway, coming to you from Annapolis in front of the State House. This is the third week of the Poor People's Campaign, and once again people have marched along a pathway and they're now having a rally here, and it's anticipated there'll be some civil disobedience and perhaps some people going to jail.
We demand an end to military aggression and warmongering.
Yes.
We demand a stop to the privatization of the military budget and any increase in military spending.
Yes.
We demand a strong veteran system that remains public.
Yes.
We demand a ban on assault rifles and a ban on easy access to firearms.
Yes!
We demand the demilitarization of our communities on the border and in the interior.
Yes!
We demand an end to federal programs that send military equipment to local and state communities.
Yes.
We demand that the call to build a wall at the United States and Mexico border be ceased.
Yes.
We demand an immigration system that, instead of criminalizing people for trying to raise their families, prioritize family reunification, keep families together, and allows us all to build thriving communities in the country we call home.
Thank you.
When we took our oath of enlistment, we swore to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, also to obey the orders of the President of the United States and officers appointed over me. Well, if I was still serving today, I'd have a problem following 45's orders. America's discretionary budget is about $1 trillion, with more than half going towards the military, spending, and the VA. One of the fundamental principles of the Poor People's Campaign is to transform the war economy into a peace economy that values all humanity. The war economy and militarization is so destructive that taking life and limb is not enough for soldiers. That's not enough. Now the war machine wants to control your mind by making you believe that kneeling during the national anthem is disrespectful to the flag and our veterans. Well, as a Vietnam veteran, I find that appalling.
One of the things I have to say is that I was involved with the first March on Washington, the Poor People's Campaign, that took place in 1968. I helped prefab the housing for Resurrection City. And in fact, I understood back then that our government was wasting our tax dollars on the war in Vietnam, while at the same time making the claim that they did not have money to address the needs of poor people here inside the United States. And I felt that Dr. King was very correct in pointing out that, in saying that, in fact, that the war budget economy of the United States is a direct threat to addressing the needs of poor people in this country. In fact, he brought up the point that every year the military budget grew while the war on poverty budget shrank. Mm-hmm. And so that is just as true back in 1968 as it is today.
Martin Luther King, the 1968 Poor People Campaign, but that galvanized in D.C., even though it was muddy and wet, right?
Big time.
They came for jobs, bread, food, civil rights, etc. And they, some of them got on buses, some of them walked. You know the story.
Yes.
I don't have to tell you the story.
I was there.
Right? You were there. So what galvanized them was not the war in Vietnam. The war in Vietnam was very important, but what galvanized them was their basic survival needs.
Yes.
And this, I guess what I'm seeing is this message is over their heads. It's real, and it is the message that they have to learn.
Mm-hmm.
And it is the lever in which they will have to press in order to make changes.
Mm-hmm.
But what moves it. You know,
and I think that's one of the big weak points right now this group has. This group tends at this stage of the game not to really focus on that part of the community that are most adversely affected by the very policies that they're complaining about.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is a need for more outreach, more going to those communities. The unfortunate thing is you and I, as we were growing up, we spent most of our time in those very communities and the organizations we were involved in.
Mm-hmm.
Many of the young people today that takes the leadership in this organization here, I don't believe are spending that much time in those communities and feel very uncomfortable in going into those very communities that we used to sell newspapers in and we used to talk to people and talk about these issues. I don't think that the message is bad. I think the fact is that if people can't hear the message because you're not bringing it to them, then you're not going to get them involved.
Yeah,
I think the message is on point.
It is.
But
it is.
We have to take the message to them.
Mm-hmm.
And I find that this is a weakness.
Mm-hmm.
Is that I strongly believe that they should spend much more time in doing political education.
Mm-hmm.
They're operating from a perspective of top down
mm-hmm.
rather than from bottom up.
Mm-hmm.
And until that happens, we're going to have a weakness in this movement. This movement really needs to spend more time listening
mm-hmm.
before they even start talking.